My name is Ali Sadun Engin, and I am from Science and Research Foundation. Science and Research Foundation is located in Istanbul, Turkey. Its honorary leader is Mr. Adnan Oktar. Adnan Oktar is a Muslim author who lives in Istanbul, Turkey. He is 51 years old, and he uses the pen name Harun Yahya. So far, he wrote more than 250 books in his own language, Turkish, and his works are translated into more than 57 different languages. Today, I'd be honored to communicate his views to you. So, my presentation is about scientific evidences of creation and again some scientific evidences for the miracles of the Holy Quran. Before moving on to examples, of course, I would like to underline very important facts. First of all, as Muslims, we know that we don't need any scientific justification for our faith. However, on the other hand, we know that, again, scientific evidences are perfect tools to communicate Islam to others. And of course, scientific evidences, again, increases our faith. This is very important. So, first of all, I would like to explain you the meaning of design, the concept of design. What is design? What is the meaning of to be designed? Imagine that you're on a seashore. Anybody can guess more or less what can happen by chances and coincidences on the seashore. It is quite possible that by the random crashes of the waves, for instance, some small wounds, some pits, some shapes that reminds us letters, it is quite possible that all of those things can happen, can come into being by chance and coincidence. However, if you come across to a sandcastle like this, and if you see that, this sandcastle has got its specific towers, its bridge, its hull, for instance, everybody knows that this sandcastle can't be a product, a result of chances and coincidences, nor the random weather conditions. This is not possible. This is impossible, and anybody who will claim that this can be a product of a chance, this is clearly and simply insanity. Because we certainly know that in the past, some hours ago, for instance, children who were playing on the seashore, they certainly built the sandcastle for a specific purpose. And moreover, we don't need any scientific justification to believe in that this sandcastle is the product of children who are playing on the seashore. Well, from the same point of view, when we look around in the nature, we come across to different living creatures, beautiful living creatures. They got much more amazing designs if you compare them with the very simple design of the sandcastle. Well, let me explain you the first living creature. This is the honeybee. Honeybees are amazing creatures, first of all. Honeybees, I'm not going to go into deep detail about their body structures, their biological structures. However, I would like to explain to you their organization in the hive, the way how they live, the way how they're organized. It is very, very interesting. First of all, let me give you some brief information about the bees. Some 50 to 60,000 of the bees, they live in a hive, and the majority of this population consists of female honeybees. And there are some male bees, and there's only one queen bee. And inside the hive, there's a perfect organization. The female bees, the worker bees, almost all of them, they carry out the daily tasks. Almost all the daily tasks are carried out by them. What are they? For instance, the defense of the hive, going around and collecting nectars from flowers, feeding the larvae, are all the daily tasks. On the other hand, male bees, well, what they do is simply nothing. They don't do a lot of things. They just go and inseminate the queen bee. But what is interesting about their life is that their life is divided into stages. It is very interesting. From the very moment when they were born, they start clean the hives. They just clean the hive. For the very first 3 days of their lives, this is their first stage, they just clean the hive. All of the worker bees, all of the female bees, in perfect harmony. They don't refuse anything. They just clean the hive. This is their only task. But at the end of this first stage, amazingly, they stop doing this. Now, their body starts to secrete a secretion which is called royal jelly. And using this royal jelly, they feed the larvae. This is what they do. And they work as babysitters. They feed the larvae for 1 week. This is their second stage. At the end of the second stage, which is the 10th day, again, all of them, amazingly, all of a sudden, their body stops to secrete this royal jelly. And the third stage is now they start to build the honeycombs with a secretion which is called the wax. Now their body starts to secrete the wax. So it is very interesting. At this point, we have to think about an important thing. Wherever you go, all around the world, in China, in South Africa, in Asia, in America, in Europe, bees are always building their hives with a six-sided shape, which is called hexagon. Now, why hexagonal? Why hexagonal? Why not five-sided shapes? Why not four? Why not three? So this is very interesting. To this question, the answer comes from the math. Now, if you want to produce a material, and if you want to store this, the best shapes in mathematics is hexagons. Let me tell you why. If you use circular shapes, as you see on the slide, at the center of the circles, you're going to lose some space. This is not the best way. Now, if you use five-sided shapes, again, you're going to lose some space. This is not the best way neither. Now, if you use triangles and rectangles, okay, you're not losing any space in between. However, mathematically speaking, the circumference of triangles and rectangles are greater than hexagons. So as a result, what bees are doing for thousands of millions of years, it is to use the minimum amount of wax in order to store maximum amount of honey. And the way how they build the honeycombs is another mathematical amazing miracle that amazes the mathematicians. Now let's see how they build it. Thousands of the bees, thousands of them, they start to build the honeycombs from different points of the hive, as you see on the slide. If you compare this hexagons on the right and left-hand side, they're perfectly the same. And when they come to join the very last hexagon at the center, you don't see any mistake. It's flawless. How come? Now think about it. There is no, all the inner angles are perfectly calculated. And if you measure the very last hexagon, its circumference is perfectly and strictly the same with the very first hexagon they have made in the very, very beginning. Now think about yourself. I'll show you the perfect hexagons that the bees make. If I give you a piece of paper in your hand and a pen and ask you to do the same thing, to draw perfect hexagons without any tool, starting from different points of the paper and joining them right at the center, would you be able to do that? No, I don't think so.